So I think I will start with this question. So how many of you have already started this SQL Server on Linux? Anybody has started trying?
You mean to say Googling?
Yeah, Googling I think everyone is doing. So who started doing some practical? Anybody? Oh, that's nice. That's awesome. Okay. So really, since actually Microsoft launched SQL Server, actually I just want to tell you, I was part of the private preview, means when the product they were building, so I was working with Microsoft team. So I was keep giving some feedbacks, whatever I could, free time I could figure it out, and I was helping them. So honestly, I was able to kind of find only one issue, which I can tell them. So they already fixed, so it was like already that was in the queue. So then after that, it started and I realized really it's an awesome product. And why I'm saying it's not because I see a lot of people around. When I joined the private preview, around 2,000 people. And I think at the end, like before this announcement, around 22,000 people were participating in private preview. So it was like a very awesome thing. Like you get connected with a lot of Microsoft people where you learn a lot of things. You get their input and how it works. So, and that's where really I got fascinated with this Urban Panda. So, and then I started exploring this website. Actually, Urban Panda, it has a lot of information. Whenever you get time, just go and Google. Probably you will get more information. So today's session, actually, I'm going to cover these all the things. First thing, why SQL Server on Linux? Second, We all know that there is a new version of SQL Server. We call it SQL Server vNext. But why we call it vNext? Means like you see, I don't know. You have monitor. You have started exploring this portion. Like you will get the ISO file, and you will also get the file something called Debian package or RMP package. You will see. So why this vNext version? Then I put 13 number of demos. Probably I can do more, but I'll see what I can do within the time frame. And then what is currently supported version and unsupported version, and then SQL file, basically basic architecture. I will be doing the next session, so I will be covering end-to-end the architecture, most of the part in depth. Probably if possible, time allow, I will use Win Debugger to show the how internally it flows. So this is all the agenda which I'm going to cover in this session. So first thing, why SQL Server on Linux? So first thing, because it till now it was like very limited to SQL on Windows. So when they launch on SQL Server on Linux, it's basically now it's all the across the platform. So any platform now you can use the SQL Server on Linux. Second thing, till now, if anybody, any your client wants to use SQL on Linux, it's like they had to go with Windows. There was no choice for them. The third thing is like Oracle and MySQL databases are, they are across the platform. Only SQL was not across the platform. The fourth thing, I was just reading this article, probably you already went through this article. So this Ars Technica says that last 3 years, the demand for SQL on Linux got increased a lot. So the database general manager, his name is Rohan Kumar. So he said that that's the one of the reason we wanted to explore. So there is a history, if you know Salava Ox, he's the guy who developed SQL SOS. We call SQL Server operating system. So he was actually doing some project. After that, he was searching for some other project. So that when he was searching some other project, so like SQL team asked him, why not let's work on the SQL on Linux. That's where he came in the picture. He worked with MSR team, Microsoft research team, and then he started working on Drawbridge project. Then that's where he finally developed this SQL Server on Linux. So the first picture came from him. It was in 28 February 2015, and the first announcement came, it was 3rd March 2016. So it's already a long time. They worked in background a lot, then they came in the picture. So this is all about, and the vNext, actually vNext is a version. This is same binary, means binary will be same for it goes to the Linux and it goes to the Windows or it goes to the Docker system. So means you can download, but the file extension will be different. For Windows, it will be ISO. For Linux, you will be probably Debian package you will be downloading. For Docker, the Docker related whatever package is there, you will be downloading. So as of now, the officially supported is like Cloud, Docker, Linux, Ubuntu, and Red Hat, and the Windows Server. But if you want to explore, because CentOS is a community-driven operating system, and it's free. So if you want to explore this on CentOS, then you can use CentOS. And it's actually a copy of, you can say, the Red Hat. So you can, I have already installed and tested. It's working perfectly fine there. So I will jump into the demo, because probably that's the most fascinating part. You want to see that what is, how it looks like. So, sorry?
Is it GA?
Yep. So tell me which SQL Server instance here is running on Linux and, sorry, let me zoom it. So which SQL Server instance here is running on Linux and which one is running on Windows? Any guess?
The above one is Linux.
Okay, the above one is Linux. Anyone, anybody else wants to try?
Yes, above one is Linux.
Okay, anybody else? Okay, one, definitely one will be there, either first one or second one. Okay, so let me go to the system and I'll show you which one is running where. Okay, so I'm just going to the first one and I'm just connecting and just writing select version. Okay, and I'll run as a message box, so you'll see it's running where, the first one. It's running on Windows 10 Pro machine on my system. Okay? Yeah, now you can change your statement. It's, and let's see the second one where it is running.
But you have 50% chance of getting it correct, right?
Yeah, you have. That's why I was wanted to check who is going to get the.
It's not an educated thing, right? You just guess.
Sorry?
Throw a dice and guess.
I just wanted to check by seeing this one, how you feel like. Is it running on Windows? You can figure it out. It is running on Windows or Linux. So now you see, it's running on CentOS. You can probably, I'll just zoom in. So you can see here, it's running on CentOS. Okay, so by seeing this one as a physical view, is you won't come to know it's running on Linux or it's running on a Windows system. So even like simple, if you want to create just one example, this is my instance which is running on Linux machine. If I want to create a database, I'll simple go, I'll just say SA, just hit enter. So the database will be created. So like the way we used to create in the Windows. So there is, if you are thinking, oh, I need to remember all my Linux command, no, actually not. When it comes to your administration part, yeah, you have to remember some commands. That is all related to the Linux. So I'm going to my Linux machine, and let me connect to the hypervisor once again and open the Linux machine. So this is my machine. So I'm going to connect this. I think it is visible or not. Just let me know. Oh, I think I'll try with zoom option if I can. Okay, first I need to come out. Okay, let me do one thing. I'll first connect with the Linux system and then I'll zoom it out. That will be easy for us, otherwise it is problematic always. So I'm keying my login username and that's my password, and we use IP config in Windows to check the IP, and I'm using here if config, probably if you are already aware of the Linux command. So this is the IP. I'll just read it out for you. It says 10.1 second. I'll just key at the same time. So I'll just close this, and I'm opening this putty here, and I'll just key the 10.104.68.103.
So
Yeah, it's running on the VMware, so I can show you. Here is my VMware, and here is the machine which is running. So the first machine which is running. So I you can see the name here. It says SG Ubuntu Online. So I connected already here. So it's asking. It's a connecting as a user, Sachit. I think probably this is visible now.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'm just keying the password. So I will just check the host name. So here I connected with that machine, and I'll just check the host name. So this is the same host name it says. Okay, so I'll clear the screen. So I'll just check, have I installed anything here or not? So DKPZ, it's actually Debian package which we can use to check the Debian package is installed or not. So I'm just going to check SQL Server. So it says no, I don't have any package here. Okay, so I think I need to just increase the font size from here, probably that will be better. You can change the setting, logging terminal. So font size, I'll just make it 16, apply. So I think this, now it's visible. Background also.
On this projector, it is very visible.
Okay. Oh, is it? I'll just change it to color. I think, yeah, if we turn up. Now it's okay, I think. Is it okay? Or still not?
Same border, I think. Don't use Korea, use same border.
Which one? Bolder.
Korea new,
yeah.
Bold? Use the bold version. Yes.
I think this is okay, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have already checked the package. So I have written couple of blocks on this. So I will follow because that will give you the understanding of both. So first part, we are going to install SQL Server on Linux. So first thing, because we are going to install something on server, so we have to connect it as a root user. So I will say sudo minus I, so it will ask me password. So I will just key the password, and after that I will be connected as a root user. And then I will check, I can connect my Linux system using PuTTY, means I am in network, so I don't need to check the network portion. So I'm going to download this key, Microsoft GPZ key. So I'll just go here and simply key here. We got syntax with it. So I just need to remove that word syntax. So here it will download. And then next step is we need to download the Ubuntu related repository from Microsoft website. So I'm going to download this. So it's completed already, the first portion. I'm going to I'll just put it. So it will just download. So it's already completed. And then I'll just check any update is there or not. Ubuntu related, so let it get all the updates by the time. So it's all actually the update which I'm getting, it's related to Ubuntu, not related to SQL, because I haven't installed SQL till now. So I'm going to install now SQL Server. So this is the command, sudo. Actually, I'm already connected as a root user, so I don't need to type sudo, but okay, I'll just try with apt-get install. Apt-get install is the command which says whatever package you want to install. Okay, so I'll just copy this, and I'll just clear this screen, and I'll just paste it here. So let's see, it's going to install all the, I think it's pretty much visible here. Yep, so it's downloading all the packages from all the related binaries, whatever needs to be downloaded from the website, and it's installing. It will take few seconds to complete. So by the time it's installing, let's see what is the, so when we are install, okay, so during the configuration, it will ask us to key the SSH password, and it will ask us to start the services, SQL service, and then it will ask to reboot the SQL Server, the final, once we install successfully. So here it's done. So I'm going to do the now configuration. So we have done the installation here. Okay, I'm now going to do the configuration of the SQL Server. So it's asking me, do you want to accept the license agreement? I will say yes. So it's saying, please enter the password for system, SA account password is asking. So I'll just key a password there. And then re-enter the password. And it will just configuring the password. Okay, now it's asking me, do you want to start the SQL service? Yes. Do you want to boot the SQL service? Yes, you say that. So your SQL service already started. So let's verify your SQL Server service is running or not. So this is the command. System, I think I'll just zoom it this one. So this is the command which you can see. Systemctl status SQL Server. So I'll just copy this and run it. So we can see our SQL Server is running here. So one thing, when normally when we install SQL Server from Windows package, you get all the options. You want to install SQL Server tools, SQL Server full text search, replication, or whatever options are there, you can select those options. Here, you have to actually install one by one. Once you install SQL Server, then you need to install the SQL Server tool. So tool doesn't mean that I'm talking about SSS, what you call Management Studio. I'm talking about the command prompt tool, okay? So this is confirmed, we are running SQL Server, so I can check for you the like SQL, this is the config of, sorry, IP of the server. So I'll just copy this IP and I'll go to the Management Studio and I'll just connect this, I'll put this IP and I'll just key the password and it's connected. So you can see here is your SQL Server, it's already running. So this is what just now we installed.
They have the Management Studio package.
Okay, as of now, they are planning to do it, but as of now, there is no SS Management Studio for Linux operating system, but you can connect Linux instance on the Windows server using Management Studio. And they have developed one tool called, I'm probably wrong with the name. It's a VS Microsoft tool, some tool they have developed.
Yeah, so the VS code, which is running cross-platform.
Cross platform.
Has a plugin for
MS, yeah.
So you can sort of
install. So you will get the GUI option on the Ubuntu system, and you can play with the Linux operating system there directly. So you don't need to switch to the Windows system where you are connecting with Linux instance on a Windows system Management Studio. Okay? So okay, I'm going to now, this is done. So we have already done how we install this SQL Server. Now we will be installing the tool on the server. So because if I want to connect, like if I say SQL CMD and E, the local host, and then I say user as a SA and the password as a P at the rate. This is the password. So if I say it says SQL CMD is not found. So basically, I don't have this tool on the server. So I need to install this tool here. So again, I need to tool related whatever repositories are there. I need to download. So I will just first download. So I'm already first step in the on the website. It says connected as a root user. So I'm already connected. So I'm not following the first step. So I will go and download that. And then it says get the update, because I encounter one time some issue. So in this demo, I don't want to encounter issue because we are already running out of time. And so I will install the tool here. So okay, one thing we just want to highlight. When you install the tool, it actually, there is some dependent package are there, like ODBC. So that will automatically get installed, okay? So it will ask during the installation. So I will just paste here this command, and it is going to install the tool. So I just remove, because anyways, I'm root user. So it is going to install this. It's saying yes. It's actually asking me, because it's going to take 156 MB space on my machine, so it's just asking me, can I take that much space? I'll say yes. So it will start again installing, and probably you will get some prompt that accept the license term. Here is the snapshot, so straight for that, I think.
So what's the user account that the services are running
at? As of now, MS SQL account. So all the services which is running on SQL related on the Linux or any Linux, Red Hat, or any system which is being owned by MS SQL account. So they are still working, like their next phase is like implementing how the Windows AD account can be authenticated on Linux system. That's the next area. There are a couple of areas they are working, like full text search, replication, agent.
So right now you cannot log in as an Active Directory user?
No, you cannot. So here the license term, so I will say just yes. So it will continue. Then it will prompt me for the ODBC. No, it's by default it will be created. By default it will be created. So again, it's for asking now for the ODBC. So they have, I think it's a now it's a publicly available. It's a like a open source kind of tool now, ODBC. Okay, so we are done with here. So I will just try to run that command, and I'll just copy it here. I think probably better the SQL CMDS localhost. I will say user as SA, password as. So yeah, we are connected with the SQL Server on Linux machine. So I'll check the version. Yeah, SQL CMD, yeah, SQL CMD prompt. Yeah, you can say SQL command prompt. So this is the, now we are connected here, okay? So we have installed till now SQL Server on the Linux machine. We have installed SQL tool on the Linux machine. Now we are going to, we have already seen how it is connecting, so no need to see how we can connect SQL Server on the Linux. Probably you must be thinking, why I'm every time using IP, not using the host? Because the browser service is still, agent is not there, browser service is not there. That's why I'm just taking IP to connect to the instance, not the host name. And let's see the error log. So we can read from error log as usual. This is the my, I'll just remove these two instances. So this is the normal machine. So you go write sp read error log. So you can read all the error log here. This is the one way to read. Another, you can use this command like here, sp, I think, sorry, sp read error log. Go, so you can, but the problem with this, the format is not readable format, so probably you will face a lot of challenges to read this. So what is the best way to read if you want to read on this machine? So I'm just exiting from the SQL command prompt, and I'll go to, you need to go to the this location called cd. This is the root, this is the root location, we call it in Linux machine. Like in SQL Windows, we have program folder where we go as a root folder, right? So this is the root folder. I'll just clear this screen. And this is the root folder. Oh, sorry, the cd. So here you can see. So it has data folder. So where as of now, it doesn't have a separate folder for like log file. So it has a data folder, it has a log folder, and this is a ms.config. So that portion I will talk about later. So I'll just go to the cd and log. So log, we'll see what all the log file it has. So you can see the error log it has. It has Hecton related, in memory related files here. You have extended event related files. Default trace we have, right? So we have default trace. So I'll just read the error log file. So I'll just clear this screen, and cat is basically reading the error log file. So I'll just read the error log file. So it's more better way to read this error log file from using the cat. Okay? Any question till now here? If anything, just let me know. Okay. Yeah, we have. Actually, I tested that one. I was encountering some issue, but we can do the offline installation. Then we can see the status, because if you are doing something on, probably you can check the status, how you can check the status. So again, as we started like SQL, we were checking the status, right? Systems CTL status, MS SQL Server. So it's for the status of the service. So what about you want to stop the service? So just put it, remove the status and just put it stop. So it will stop the service. Can we verify that? Yeah, it's failed actually, it says stop status. So same way we can start, we just need to remove status with the start word. So it will start the service. Let's again verify the status. So it's not running. So you want to enable or disable, we have a command which we can enable, disable the status. So simply again you need to put disable here. If I go here and it has put option disable, so it will disable. It says actually this portion which you are seeing, this one, it has a file, config file. So actually it removes the entry from there, something like that. So I will definitely, in the next session when I said I will be talking about the architecture more, then where I will be covering this area, where we can see this file is actually. And then we can, okay, let's verify the status when I say disable. So it's actually running. So I just stop it. and try to start stop. And let's start. It should throw error. Status. So it's actually started. Okay. And then I'll just enable the, it will throw the error if I say the enable because it's already running. And what is the status? It should show you the status. It's disable state. It's running state. Probably. So here is actually, here is the status. It says disable because I have disabled even though it's running. So let's change to disable to, I'll change to enable state. So it's enabled now, and let's see the status what it says. So it says now enabled. So this is the way we want to disable the status, like you want to do some activity on the server, you want to for a moment you want to disable the services, how you can do it. So these commands, using this command, you can enable, disable, or you can change the status of the services. And then we'll talk about, so this one is actually very important. Like we are mostly working on SQL, means we are mostly working dealing with the Windows system. We very less deal with the Linux system, or probably the organization demand is there, like being a DBA, you need to deal with the some of Linux system also. So one of the biggest challenge which we find, like how I want to copy the file to the Linux machine, there are a lot of tools are there. So, but as of now, they launch in the market, and probably you are not so familiar. So this is the best tool which I found. I was exploring Samba. Samba, probably Indian movie, if you know, the Samba word exists for very famous movie. So I'm just going to install the Samba. On this machine, actually, I installed the Samba already. Reason why, because it's a 70 MB file, and it takes a lot of time to get downloaded. So I just already installed. Oh, sudo Samba, something wrong. So you see, it was very fast, actually. It's just trying to get the update. It is not installing. So it's already installed. So what I'm going to do, I will create an account there. I will share a folder on a Linux machine, which we can access from the Windows machine. So that you want to copy some file which you want to like backup. You want to move backup on the Linux machine so that you can restore. So how you can do it? So we will follow this one. So first thing what we need to create, we need to assign a user and change the password to that user. So my user is Sachit, so I'm just using like Samba password minus a Sachit. So it will ask me to key the new password for this user. So I will key the password, and it will ask me to re-enter. So I will just re-enter the password. So this user added to that Samba software, okay? And now the next step, it says, I will create a, because I want to put a backup in a separate folder. So I need to create a folder, right? So I will go this place, and I'm selecting this var opt folder to put the backup folder there, because if you put this SQL under root folder, probably SQL won't allow you to let the control on that folder. As of now, probably it will be fixed. So I'm going to this location, and I'm going to create a folder called SQL backup folder. So as of now, I just see ls minus l, it will show me what all the folders are inside. So I have only one folder called ms SQL folder. So I'm going to create a folder called this mkdir command will create a folder called SQL backup folder. So I've created, let's verify the folder exists or not. So we can see that now the folder is there. So but one thing we need to notice, now this folder is being, the access is being held by the root user. Means someone who is root user, he can do everything. But probably the account which I added as a Sachit, he's a not root user. Until unless I key him as a go as a root user. See here, I'm acting as a root user, not as a Sachit user. So I can show you if I exit from here, then it will go to the Sachit. But Sachit is not a root user. So if Sachit user account wants to do something on this folder, he cannot do. So I need to give the access to SQL, as someone asked me the question, which account is being used. So I will give the access here to SQL account, so that SQL, when I'm taking the backup or copying the backup, it can go to the there directly. So I will be changing the permission now. So I will be here sudo. This is the command which I will be using to change the permission. So it will first change. Just 1 second. Okay, wait a second. Yep. Something old. Yep. And let's verify now. Sorry, I need to go to that location first to see it got that permission got changed or not. So you see now previously both were root. Now this is the MS SQL. And then I will change the group access again. So here I will just change the group access, and I'll just verify ls minus l. So now SQL Server got the access on this folder. So I want to take a backup. I can take directly there on this folder backup. So if as a user, like I'm Sachit, if I want to copy something here, even though I cannot, because SQL Server has the access on this folder now, from root user to transfer to the SQL user. So I want to give access to the Sachit also. When I will be logging this folder, means when I will be accessing this folder from the outside, so the root user you cannot access. So you need some user account which you have created. So in this case, on this machine, I have created Sachit. So Sachit account can access that folder. So I'll show you how we can achieve that. So here is the username. So I will just put the Sachit. So I'm giving him read write access on that folder. So he can, but we cannot verify this Sachit has access or not from here. So he got the access there. Okay. And I'm going to take the backup. So I will connect, I will create a test database there, and I'll try to take a backup directly there. So I'll go here and create a test database. So, okay. And I'll just backup database name, suppose in this case SA to disk equals to, this is the location we have. So I'll just copy this location and paste it here, and I'll just put it sa.bak. Sorry, am I doing something? No, this is the same connection, right? Oh, sorry, I'm on wrong machine connection. Yep. So it's completed. So let's verify in this folder. Now I have backup or not? So I'll go to the SQL backup folder and I'll check. So we can see SA backup. I just now took the backup, right? So we have the access backup. So means SQL Server can access this folder now. Let's configure the Samba so that you can access this folder from outside, means like from Windows machine. So I'll go here and I'm going to open the, using VI editor, I'm going to open the Samba configuration file. So I'll go here, clear here. So I'll go to the last. This is the last where I will be putting the information. What is my share for folder name and which account will be accessing. So what is the path? So I will just press insert to write there. And I have already written the script. So I'll just copy here. So this is the script. So this is a shared folder name. So I'll just paste it here. So what I'm doing here, I'm saying this is the shared folder name. SQL backup is the shared name of the folder. And then this is the path. So we already know this path. We have taken the backup. And the username, I'm just going to put the Sachit. So I'll just put Sachit as a username, and I'm read only, no, it can be browsed and it can be written. So I'll just press skip colon sign WQ. So it is actually the, now whatever I put it there, it is written in the this Samba config file, and I need to restart the Samba service. So I'm going to restart the Samba service now. So it, No, it's a free open source. You can just download. Okay, so we already know the, I'll just check the IP. So this is the IP. So I'll go to my Windows machine. I should be able to access. So here is the folder. We can see the folder now. And I'll just, it will ask me to key the username. So I key the username Sachit, and I will key the password so I can access the folder. This is what the backup we have taken. And in case if I have any backup, suppose on my machine, let's assume that I have any small file, I just copy something. Or this is the, probably I have this file, so I'll just copy here. So it's copied here. I'll go to the Linux machine again, and I'll just verify, is it there? So we can see. So this is the way, it's very easy way to transfer the files if you want to transfer backup and all those things. So any question till now in terms of starting the service, how we can see the error log, and how we can copy Samba in case, because that's the reason I especially put all those detail in the slide, so that in case whatever we are discussing and you want to explore it, we will be definitely uploading this slide on the user group. So you can download and you can refer all those things. So I'm not doing anything extra. Maybe probably I'm a bit fast because you feel like I'm moving very fast. So because I need to cover a couple of at least demos so that you can get the feel. And when you start doing, probably you need to spend a lot of time. It's as we are thinking, it's not as easy. But yeah, when you will spend a lot of time, then probably you will get more familiar with the this command and all those things.
Are the files compatible with Windows?
Which file?
The database files.
Yeah, those are the compatible with the Windows. So means I can detach and attach there. I can detach from Linux machine and I can attach in the Windows. So there is no issue as such. Sorry?
Default port number?
It's a 1433.
Same.
So I will be changing the default port number also to show you. So again, I will go to the, what is here? So backup, we have options. If you want to directly download the backup, so you can follow this, like simply you go here and you can copy this link, and here is the command. So you can we have already this backup. I just want to remove this backup. rm-rf wide. So I will just remove. Let's see, this backup got deleted. Yeah, it's deleted. I'll just show you the Windows level. Yeah, it's no more there. So we have deleted from the Linux machine. So in case you want to download this backup directly, you can use this command, and here is the link. I'll just show you quickly how you can download. Because probably you have a need where you want directly download this backup file on your Linux machine. So I'll just go here, copy this link. So it's actually, if you are aware, Microsoft already removing this adventure work database now. So I have attached the new worldwide importers database. So you can directly download here. So I will just go here and put, so it start downloading. So it will take few minutes. And then if you want to restore, you can go ahead and restore that database. And here, I'll just show you, I think it will take few minutes, 30% already completed. Just wait another few seconds. Yeah, it's done. So we can see, so it's already, you might be thinking, oh, now the color is white, previously it was green, it's because of some permission when you are copying from Windows to Linux machine. And then, do you want me to, okay, because this one is complicated, that's why I want to show you how you can restore this backup. Because as of now, I just want to highlight, if your backup file has in-memory feature enabled and you want to restore, so with move command, you can move data file and log file. But in-memory option, you cannot. So I want to highlight this area. So here you see this section. So here I'm doing as a forward slash. If you see this, I'm doing as a forward slash here. But especially this memory table, I'm doing the backward slash, right? The reason why it's not as of now supported, they are still working. So it will be fixed soon. So if that's why I just wanted to show you, if you are okay to see the how we can restore this case, then I'll just quickly show you. We have already backup. So I'll just go here and verify this command, because probably I need to change this a bit. I'll go to the management studio and here is the management studio, and I just need to replace this with probably match all, replace all, and then yep, I think so. Here, let's just say okay. In public preview, I just need to delete this whole line. So I can see it's okay. Yeah, it's compiling. So I can try to restore. Home, it's okay. The folder location is different. So I'll go just copy this location. Let's refresh. So it's started restoring. So whatever backup we have downloaded on Linux machine, so we can, like I was, as he was saying, that compatible. So same, this is the same file which you download for the Windows machine. So I downloaded same backup file on the Linux machine, so it is compatible. So we can see we can restore the backup file there. And now I think we'll go ahead with the port detail. Yep, changing the port. You asked how to change the port here. So in, we don't have assets like SQL Server Configuration Manager in Linux, but they do have one file called MS SQL Config. That file is actually replacement of SQL Server Configuration Manager. So using that file, you can change port, you can change default location of backup folder, you can change default location of data file, log file, and even trace. So those high-level things which you can do. I think I can show you what all the things you can do with that. So I'll just go to this. This is the tool, and I'll just say minus H. So you can see these are all the things which you can change with this config tool as of now. So you can set, unset the password, you can set the collision settings, you can enable the trace flag, and you can validate. Validate is basically, you do the server level setting change, so that settings will be captured, this validation, it will create a file and that it validates when you restart. What are the default setting and what has been changed by the user? So that file gets created. And then list again, so I will just, as I put it here as minus H, so I will just put it as a, where is that file? I'll just copy here, and I'll just say list. I think, I'll just show you the list detail one second. So anyways, just first let me just change to the this, what we call the default port. So first we need to check which port it is running. So I'll just, one second, let me go to the out and here. So this is the command where you can see which all the ports as of running on the, what all the ports being used by which service. So I'll just run netstat and hyphen tulpn. Sorry, netstat, I just put it start. So we can see these are all the services which is running. So SQL service, you can see as of now, probably we need to, so here we can see the service 1433, sorry, this one, SQL related service is running. So I'll just change this port to new port. So I will go here and I'll just type here, so I just put it 2381, okay. So applying, this says that applying the new port to SQL service, but we have to restart the services. So I'll go ahead and restart this service. So again, I am going to run systemctl restart SQL, MS SQL service. So this is the command. So it will restart the service. And now I again verify which port it is listening now. Yes, as of now, I haven't tested honestly, and I didn't get any document related to have multiple instances running. But yeah, I can install and can get back to you on that. Yep. No, sorry, I didn't understand.
In this command, we are giving MS SQL hyphen server. So
Oh, that you mean to say multiple service. That's why I'm saying I need to one time I need to check and then get back to you how we can do that. So I'll go here and I'll check the port number now. So this is the port number which is listening now, 2381. So let's verify from the management studio. So can I connect using 2381? So here is the 2381. And so yes, so we have changed the port and we can connect using that port. And this is the default, like if you want to change, you created a default folder for log file and the data file and you want to change the folder, so you can use same command, just you need to change the parameter instead of like port number you passed it, you can pass it like SQL log folder where you want to put it that folder. So here is the command. So actually, I'm in this folder. I'm creating a separate log file folder. I'm changing the access to the SQL service so that it can access. And then here I'm changing. So here is the location which I'm setting. So basically, once I change, I created the folder. I have given the access to SQL service to access that folder. So then I am setting here the default log directory, which is this folder. So once I set, then it will ask me to restart. The moment I restart, it will be applicable. So when I create a database, the file log file will go to that location. And the best thing, I think, how many times anybody has rebuilt collision at this instance level? Have anyone tried on Windows system? Rebuilding collision setting means like you install the SQL Server, but the reinstall, but it was a very painful. Mainly, like not really reinstall. There are options you can uninstall, reinstall, as you said that, or you can rebuild master data, and that's where you can do that. So it's a kind of rebuilding all the options, right? So, but it is very painful task. Let's see in SQL Server Linux how we are changing the collision setting. So, first step, I'm saying that I'll just zoom it out. First step, I'm saying connect as a root user. So basically, we are already connected, so no need to do anything there. I'll just clear this screen. And then I'm saying run this MS config utility to set a new collision. So I'll just run this option. So it will ask me to key the collision. Okay, so it says we'll change the collision for SQL Server and restart the server. Continue, yes, we want to. It is asking me to give the new collision setting. So I'll just pass any collision. Sorry?
Can you check what was current running?
Okay. So I think we are already connected with this one. So why not? Let's connect here. And somewhere I must have some command to check the default one. So we can just select properties, because I can do the comparison later on, so that's why I just writing this one, server properties, and we can just collision. So this is the default one. Okay, let's whatever it is here, I'll just take it this one as a easy, because I don't need to search for the new collision. So I'll just key as a SQL Latin. I think I'll go to the Microsoft website. From there, I'll just copy paste. AI, right? AI is okay, right? I'll just change it AI. That's a nice idea. So the moment you key, it will automatically be rebuilt for you. So you don't need to do anything else. Okay, so this is done. And let's see what is the collision setting now. No, actually I put it AI only, right? Sorry, I put it the same collision setting. Just let me, we can, AS, I can put it the, yep, sorry, I just put it the AS. So basically, we can achieve it very fast. In Windows version, we have to follow a lot of steps. if you are rebuilding the master database, and probably if you are uninstalling again, it's very time consuming process. Here it's not so much time consuming process. So we have so here we can see. I haven't tested on vNext, but I'm sure we need to follow the same thing, vNext. So this one is like pretty fast. So it was vi initially, and now see here, it was vi initially, now vas. So changing collision becomes so fast. It's not one thing. There is another one thing like SA. So most of the time, as a DBA, we forget SA, what is the SA password. And we, if you want to connect SQL Server, using SA, we don't know the password, we don't never maintain, that's a problem. So using that tool, this tool gives you the option to change the SA password also. So that tool is very useful. Now the second question you might get, how come, because it's a, what about the security one? So that's where the admin portion comes in the operating system, like who is going to manage the operating system. So what kind of rights as a user you are going to have.
Here, Linux admin, is having admin
permission. Yeah, they are having an admin permission. So definitely they are still working on a couple of areas to improve that. So basically this public preview will give them more clear picture, because they will get now, as in a private preview, they have very limited customer, right? So when it is open for public, so they will get connected with a lot of people and they will get a lot of feedback. So that's where they are keep improving. It's actually, you think about, they have 40,000 million code or some thousand million code they have. So it's not practically possible to change all the codes. They started this project a long time back. They wanted to change it everything. Over the period they run the show, then after that they realize it cannot be done. Then they just scrap the project. And then after that, this MSR team, they build the drawbridge project. And that's where they get realized, because there is a project called Modri or some project was they done the. Actually, there was a Windows application they wanted to run on the Linux platform, and they were able to do that. So that's where the thought came in the picture. So what was the challenging portion? Because SQL Server talks at the user level and at the NT level. So there are some codes which still goes to the NT level, means we call it ring zero level. So they wanted to move that ring zero level codes to the upper level, means user level, so that it is not bounded with the Windows operating system only. So that's where they introduce the second layer of operating system. So this is all about the demo. Any question you have demo, let me know. I can help you further. So I'll just continue with the slides there. So this is the, as of now, the supported features. So pretty much what we have as of now in the Windows, it's all there. We as a feature wise, we can see the in-memory compression, always on encrypted, masking, service broker, data change data capture, partitioning, auditing, everything is there. And they are still working a lot of what we call it, the server level. There are a lot of features they are still enabling. Yep.
Is that the CLR there? Is that SQL CLR?
Yeah, it's a SQL CLR.
That means .NET Core.
.NET Core is already there. I think I can show you what all the core files are there. So I have written one detailed block on this tool. Probably I can just quickly go there and show you. This is called Config Manager SQL Server in depth. Now this is a service file. And then I talk about the config manager. So I'll show you what all the files when you talk about the .NET. So you can see there is a .NET file also. Yeah. So if you go, so this is the tool I have written in depth. When you run this tool, actually it creates a file. It's a create a file. So here is a list option. So you can see what all the files it does. So from there, you can, using that tool, you can see the files also. And I'm going back to the slide because I have very limited time to finish everything.
No,
it's still in progress. They are coming with replication. They are coming with always on. They are coming with all the whatever we features we have on Windows as of now. They're all bringing on the Linux and your basically vNext version. Okay, these are the unsupported features. So probably soon you will come to know the full text search is out in the market, replication also, and your agent related services will be out in the market soon. So they will be probably soon releasing another version. And this is all the, as of now, not supported features. And then introduction to SQL Pulse. So this is what I was talking about. So they have your database, they have analysis services, integration services, and reporting services. And then they introduce a new platform that's called SQL Platform Abstraction Layer. So actually, because till now, last 35 years, SQL Server has been running on Windows. And now they wanted to run on the Linux machine. So they cannot change the all 35 years work, means all the codes. So they introduced, as I said, that drawbridge project. From there, they actually identify like which call should go to the Linux machine and which call should go to the Windows machine. To achieve that, they introduce another layer of operating system that's known as a SQL file operating system. So if we zoom it, it looks like this. So here is, means like any latency related that will go to the SQL OS, so existing operating system which was introduced in 2005. And then it directly, like latency, what I mean by the latency, basically like any IO related stuff, any network related stuff, that directly goes to the host extension. And other than that, anything which goes to the Windows 32 API. So previously, those APIs was at the kernel level. Those move back to the on the top level, means user mode. So everything is now processing in the user mode. And anything which is need to be processed the kernel mode, then it goes to the host file extension and then further move on. And this is the zoom in architecture. So if you see, your database is here. Here is the Windows APIs, means when you are running your SQL Server on Windows system. So this is the API which will be called when it is running on the, like, even though it's running on the Windows, it will call the SOS APIs. And then these are the things area they have actually being dealt by the SOS V2. V2 is basically SQL Pal. Probably in future you will see they will remove SOS and they will keep only one operating system. So that is the future plan from Microsoft as of now. Because they cannot, because a lot of, there are so many IP, means instruction point in SOS, so they cannot change as they want. So they are planning to merge only one OS for everything. So probably whatever overhead, if it is there, then it will be removed also, if they make it one operating system. So, and what is the next? So what we are going to see the soon, like always on another feature which I was talking, not supported, those will be supported here, AD authentication and all those things. And the, if you are interested, then probably they have some early adoption program. Probably you will get the free licensing for whole, means some year, that you need to get connected with Microsoft to get concrete detail, how long you can get the free licensing and all those things there. And like they are pretty fast. They announced on 7th March 2016. They launched as a public preview on 16th. They announced on 7th. Public preview was 16th. And most probably in mid-2017, this will be as a normal product launch.
It's a CTP. It's not a GA.
Sorry?
It's a CTP.
It's a CTP version. It haven't released. But yeah, in US, there are, I think they were saying some, like couple of companies, they started using that. So they are using as a production environment. So those, there are customers they are using, because that's where they offer like couple of customer, like you come and in our environment, bring your data and we will do the load testing for you. Everything we'll check for you. That's what the Microsoft offering in the private preview. So many people during the past, if you know that a lot of people went there and they work with Microsoft, they share their information and they do a lot of load testing. So this is all from my side for the SQL on Linux. Anything you have, any question on this, just let me know. And probably we will do a more in-depth on especially this portion, how this work, and the tool portion, when the tool you run, actually what file it creates, which location it creates, that tool portion we will be discussing. And if you are more interested, so I will show you the calls, like as I said, that there are 7 files which will be called by when you are running the SQL on Linux. So which all those files, like system files, .NET files, certificate files, those files, how, when it is really called. So we can see that from the WinDebug.
The other alternative is to install a Docker image.
Yes, correct.
And are there any published benchmarks comparisons?
I think officially they have only one or two they have released. not a lot of. So that the one was released in 2000, it's in March itself. After that, they haven't come up with any comparison as of now. But yes, go to on channel 9, they have shown the comparison on the in-memory table, so how the faster transition is moving on. So in channel 9, they have released a couple of videos there. So that's all from my side. Thanks.